to make some scientific design of the history, you can open the book and read it by yourself if you want. But I'd like to say about some typical traits of the music and of the character, which is also the character of Russians. You see, it's a very natural thing that Russians are emotional people with spontaneity of emotions congenial with routine and strict rhyme, even in music. But it's a paradox that it doesn't mean sentimentality. Sentimentality, like sincerity, what we call heart to heart, but not like making show off emotions. And another trait which I must impart you is severe and stern side of the character and of the music the greatest Russian poet Pushkin said that we all are singing in a gloomy way, from the coachman to the first poet. I indulge myself to quote it in Russian. От ямщика до первого поэта мы все поем уныло. Грустный вой, песня русская, особая примета. Грустный вой, morning hole, morning hole. So it not means that that all music is sad. No. Sometimes it pictures celebrations. For instance, Easter fests, and crowds of people and manifestations of joy. Very often it's accompanied with the bells, with the church bells, but the significance of them is very wide, from the bells of joy, to the bells thundering of alarm and funeral bells. So it's not carry along of Catholic Church, which is more elaborated. Only several terms, but of great profoundness, which pierce the immense spaces, great distances. You may hear it from here to Bergen, as I imagine, maybe not. Another thing that influenced Russian music is a Russian landscape. Russia is a country of plains, not of mountains or seas. It does have mountains and seas, but peculiar thing is plains. These plains and the typical Russian landscape is a gentle slope, a little river, a grove of birch trees, and a white church in the distant, very small one. And the spaces are immense. They are more than the amount of inherited people, and that gives the feeling of being lonely, of being hermit, in a wild place. And Rachmaninoff, when he was old, and when was got a nice estate in Switzerland. He said, "I got my estate in Russia. It was surrounded by the fields of rye. There were no mountains, there were no seas. But for me, it's not worse, and it's not swinging." As you see, it's not swinging. No, to speak frankly, he added, "I'm eager. I was always eager to be there. To speak frankly, even now I'm eager to be there." He wrote when he was about 17, was he was age was going to an end, but he was eager to be in his estate. And so we come to the third element, that's the Russian folk songs. It's a greatest amount of them that survived hundreds of years. We have plaintive songs and merry round dances. And the space is so great that every reason has his own sort of dances, of songs. And first I'll play one of the pieces which uses exactly the folk tune. The piece is written by composer Lyadov, Anatoly Lyadov. It's a prelude in a B minor, and the song with a caption, "Oh, there is an unhappy love in the world, unhappy love in the world." But Lyadov made it not a mere arrangement of it, but he made piece, a romantic, you'll hear a romantic piece with rather intricate chords and harmonies, and you'll hear it all. Thank you. It's a very short piece. Yadov, like Mingitch's, he compiled some little turn pictures after Russian folk tales, but he himself was a man full of melancholy, so that he once composed a verse. I cannot bear standing. I cannot bear lying. I must examine if I can be hanging. So he was a very sad man inside him, and so it's in the feeling of disaster is in this prelude, and another variant of contemplating nature gave Tchaikovsky. Tchaikovsky is the most famous of Russian composers. Though there are some superlative persons as Mussorgsky and Rimsky-Korsakov and Glazunov, but Tchaikovsky gained first Europe recognition. And in his meditation that I am about to play now, gave another variant of contemplating nature. Maybe it's a contemplating of a landlord who is standing on a balcony of his manor house and observing his estate, his groves and brooks, something in it. Of this kind. But nevertheless, for me, the main idea of this piece is accepting the world, every leaf of grass, every brook, every star. The sky, and so, it's a very popular piece in Russia. It's widely performed, and you'll hear it as one of his late pieces, Meditation.
Thank you. Cecilie, det mulig å gjøre noe med varmen?
It's very cold here. He still imagines the sounding of a symphonic orchestra. All his peculiarities of notation, of using their colors, are deriving from the from his orchestral way of thinking. And even here, I've tried that one could perceive the strings and the scale of horns and even when the nightingale is singing at the end of the piece. We still imagine flute and woodwinds. That's a style peculiar to Tchaikovsky. If you look at his score, you fancy whether it's an arrangement for piano of some orchestral work. It's his style. And another thing I must stress is that playful songs, that Russia is the rare region in Europe where playful songs, drawing, had survived, because playful songs are connected with many times with epic contents and romance and dancing is another realm. And for instance, in neighboring countries with Russia, Poland or in Czech Republic, no plain drawing, slower songs had survived for their great antiquity, and drawing character of song is peculiar to Russian folk music. Quite another realm is the edge of 19th and beginning of the 20th century. It was the real renaissance in Russian culture. It turned out then Russia was expecting a revolution, but while it was she was being expected, all the creative powers were growing, and a new modern art appeared, partly influenced in painting, in architecture, by French artists and in music it gave the names of Scriabin and Rachmaninoff. They were aged, they were nearly the same, the same year when they were born. Maybe Scriabin was a year older, and I'd like to tell some words about him. He was surely a decadent. He began as a follower of Chopin and even of Tchaikovsky, and the plaintive C sharp minor study, which we heard yesterday, shows the influence of Tchaikovsky, though, and of C sharp minor slow study by Chopin. Surely. But he gives even then he gives something of his own, and his second style, his second manner, was quite new. It was influenced by Wagner and Liszt, and he tried to develop some field where he of emotions, where he tried to find the opposition between the greatest subtlety and a greatest grandeur. Therefore, he tried sometimes to be as delicate, as exquisite as possible, as sometimes to claim his power, his self-assurance, his mightiness as a creator. It sounds sometimes even with a tint of arrogance, and more and more. He was confirmed that as creator, not simply as a musician, as creator, he can change something in our world. Not to go further, I'll stop now and show you his illustrious in Russia two poems, opus 32. They exactly give the opposition of Scriabin's lyricism and Scriabin's acclaiming of power and of his that he's confirmed in his self assured, and he feels that he is a creator of first range. His lyricism tries to be very delicate, very limpid. Interlacing polyphony of voices in the first poem, and the color of trumpet, which he used to picture his will, his mightiness as a symbol, will be heard in the second poem. And the idea of both of them is the pursuit of some of something ineffable, that's symbolism of Scriabin. He is pursuing some dream, some faint ideal, and both preludes and as a something interrogative. The pursuit is failing, the ideal is fading away.
Thank you.
recordings he made. He made it on a system with wax cylinder. It's a sort of pianola. So it gives no account of sound of his playing, but we do know that his sound was rather weak. He was lack of mature mightiness. He was a tiny man with tiny hands. It was extremely delicate and very, very delicate, very, even seemed to be a volunteer. But a lot of his recordings survived, mostly of his early preludes, and the first poem, as well, which is the middle of his creative work, and his lack of power, mature power, led to the fact that he was the best heard in small spaces, like his house in the center of Moscow, near our school, where is a museum now, and some pianists can play his own Bechstein piano. And his manner was as pretended to be improvising, but he was very meticulous in counting bars, and well, he was playing to improvise some new thing. He left some blank bars to fill them later, when he would have the appropriate idea, musical ideas for this. So it looks, his music looks like improvising, but he is not. It is reckoned well as well. And you noticed, I suppose, that the first poem is a real sonata. For the second element, for the second theme of the first poem, he invented an Italian remark, inafferrando. Inafferrando means sliding away, but there's no such a word in Italian. It's his own invention. So it's the only case when the word inafferrando was ever used. And years after years, Scriabin became a mystic. He was now aware that he could really change a world, that he will compose some mystery from the capital letter, mystery. And maybe this mystery will be performed somewhere in India, some temple will be built, will be erected there in India. All the mankind will be gathered around this temple. There would be some dances, some mysterious rites. And after that, all the elements will be conquered by the world soul, and everything will be transferred. everything will be transferred, and everything will be burned in eternal flame. Eternal flame. It would be transfiguration, of the mankind, with the help of his mystery, of his Scriabin's mystery. He was so idealistic that he suspected whether other men actually existed or not. Maybe he was the only creative man in the world. And later he decided that mystery it's too hard task for them. He'll make a preliminary act. And this preliminary act for his mystery was accomplished under his fingers and in his mind. I've told you that he reconned the bars meticulously, and he was ready to put it on paper. And suddenly he died. Suddenly, in 3 days, as I have told you yesterday. And for other mystics, even now, it's a very important fact. He was stopped. He has gone too far in mysterious realm. And for those who are not mystic at all, that was the thing that the world was wrapped of a great musician who was about to create something complete new and maybe wonderful miraculous, and the famous conductor Kusevitsky, to whom Scriabin charged, who was charged with Scriabin to perform his preliminary act, said, no matter, we'll perform it and go to the restaurant to have a nice dinner. So he wasn't mystic at all. He made a brilliant career in USA. He left a great amount of recordings, Serge Kusevitsky. But for Scriabin, it was a catastrophe when he understood that he is losing everything. And now I'll play a poem, Faire la flamme, towards the flame, for the flame, if you want. And it's also a real sonata, but you'll never say so. There are two main themes. First, depicting the primary cult, even freezing, and then the will of the creator sets it to the flame, and finally depicts the eternal flame. And the eternal flame is depicted joyfully, for it's not something like Second World War, which he hadn't seen. He was like in this sense, but it's a transfiguration of all the mankind. And you see the harmonies are quite opposite even to the poems which you have heard. He invented his own style with harmonies based on fourths. And the basic was so-called Promethean chord.
C, F sharp, B flat, E, A, D.
In the beginning of his third poem, Prometheus, it's mysterious. But this very poem, which I'm about to play, it shows us a real image. But sometimes you see the fourth, which sounds like Morse code. I don't think whether he had an experience of hear it or not, but the depicting is the depicting of flame, and the poem is called "Vers la flamme," towards the flame.
Thank you.
last pieces were nevertheless tragic, though he had not noticed the beginning of the World War. Maybe he suspected that this eternal flame would be not such joyful thing, but something like Ragnarok. But not only Musk, because he was hypnotized by the idea of doom. He inherited this idea from Tchaikovsky, whom he personally knew personally. He played while being a boy for Tchaikovsky, and the intrusion of relentless, remorseless doom immediately, which brings disaster and destroying every humanity, was his idea. Maybe it's a romantic idea, but it's still human. Work. He highlighted the Edgar's poem, famous poem, The Bells, and he made a tone poem of that. And it's not a casual, but it was the theme. For which he had the greatest affinity. Where he was a young boy, he attended some cloister, and he heard the Orthodox church plain singing, and they played. They were singing in parallel fifths. And it's a peculiar trait for Rachmaninoff music, and for Orthodox singing as well. And he evokes the thundering of joyful bells and mournful bells, and bells of alert, bells of alarm, different cases. The bells emerge in his music. He was presumably the greatest pianist. He had greatest arms. With the left arm, he could span the thirteenth from C to A. Imagine. And while thumb crossing. He could spin the tenth with every finger to take the first key and his thumb crossing under E. He had a great singing tone. I'll try to perform Rachmaninoff's second sonata. It was written in 1313, just before the First World War. It's a thing of three movements, which comes each one after another, running. Sometimes you hear what is another trait of his music, the depiction of nature, of calm nature, of nature which is still surrounding the contemplative person. And this music is very popular. Not popular, but it's peculiar to Russians, this way of contemplating the calm nature, the green fields and groves and so on. You'll hear his second sonata, its original version, not the second, abridged in his late years, but as he first composed it.
Thank you. short break for maybe 15
minutes.
This bar goes here. That's again, not a rolling like
flight. Moscow, Vancouver.
Thank you. Thank you.
dreadful stroke at the piano.
You strike the nail inside, but